It is great to be back. It's like Christy thinks that's good, right? Like everyone else is like, yeah, we didn't even notice you were gone. It's cool to be back. A couple weekends ago, we were in Canada. We spent a little over a week up there with my mom and my sister, which was really cool. And then last weekend, we left Canada and went down into Michigan and spent an evening and a morning with some of Bethany's family, and we came back last Sunday night, and it was really, really cool. And one of the things that was exciting for me, just sort of to think about us as a church and a spiritual family, you know, when we got here 4.5 years ago, if there was a weekend where I wasn't up teaching, I'd get messages or, you know, people would say, hey, are you going to be on? And what they were really asking me, I discovered, was, if you're not speaking, we're not coming to church, so please let us know. And that really kind of bummed me out about us. And since I've been back, I've heard all kinds of cool things from the team and from so many of you about how the great job Ned did the last couple weeks. And if you know him even this much, his heart for Jesus and his heart for people is gigantic. So, man, anything he has to share, I just think is cool. And others who are part of our teaching team, it's just been fun to hear great feedback when Bud communicates, when Roy, who's spoken, you know, a few times here now. Actually, Roy, I don't know if you know this about Roy, but his day job, he's a rock star there. He's really high up in the organization he works for. He's a rock star. And he, after communicating here the first couple times, said to me, you know what, in 20 years of doing what I do professionally, I have never received so much positive feedback and encouragement as I did standing before the people of New Hope and communicating. And that says a lot about you guys. So thank you for being and becoming a church like that. It's incredible. So last week, Pastor Ned kicked off our new year and our new series, which actually I think this series is the perfect series to start 2016. He kicked it off by asking us a question. And this is a question that most of us, if not all of us, probably answered yes to. And so let me show you the question. It's this: are you too busy? And so I'm just going to ask that, and you can respond to me. Hey, are you guys too busy?
Yes.
I think I heard one no. It was fairly unanimous, and I think probably whoever said no was maybe either lying or just sort of misinformed. So I don't know. But we live in a world, don't we, in a culture where everyone is too busy, even if they're not accomplishing a thing. Have you ever seen this, right? Like, there's nothing to do. And if you get around certain people, even though it's like, hey, what are we going to do? Oh, nothing. We have nothing on the schedule. Relaxing. People are like this. Have you ever been around someone like that? Where there's like nothing to do. You're just like, oh, I can just have like a peaceful moment or a peaceful hour. And just like looking at them causes you to be stressed out. If I'm being honest, my wife, Bethany, is like one of those people who can literally do 93 things at the same time. She can like be texting someone, talking to someone, and typing on her computer with her toe. Like, she can do that. And so in those moments where we have like just like sort of a second to take a breath, sometimes being around her stresses me out when she's in that multitasking mode. We know people like this, don't we? Like, that are just always busy even when there's nothing going on or nothing to accomplish. Maybe for some of us, we are a person like that. And so we are, as the series graphic suggests, overbooked. And most of us kind of feel this tension of being stretched to the limit, don't we? Like, there's rubber bands on us, and they're just pulling us in every direction. And for some of us, we're just waiting for the pop, the snap, because we're just doing too much. And so we have more things on our plates than we would ever have time to accomplish. And here's the sick part: we keep adding more. And we sort of pretend like it's this sort of act of faith, like, oh God, I'll just do more and you'll provide extra time. Like, you know, we just keep doing this. And I feel this tension just like you guys do. In fact, there are a lot of weeks where I have 20 people who want to see me, and I'm lucky if I get to 10. And if I'm being totally honest, I feel guilty when that happens, because I care and I want to be helpful. And then, of course, to top it off, you know, you have crazy things happen. This Wednesday, I grabbed a sub for lunch, and I'm sitting in my office, and I'm eating a sub, so I'm not really actually doing anything. So I'm like, I put on a leadership podcast. And as the leadership podcast started to unfold, the person being interviewed started talking about something that I've probably heard 20 times, read in leadership books. And pretty much everyone in leadership and church leadership says the same thing, but this didn't help. On a busy day and a busy week, I got home like at 10 or later most nights this week. And so I'm listening to this, and the person who was talking was an executive pastor at a church in northern Indiana for 20 years. And he was brought on staff at the church when the church was 200. And when he left a little over a year ago, the church was at 6,000. And so they were asking, what were some of the key moments in the life and history of the church that caused it to go from a church of 200 to having the impact that it does today? And he said, you know, one of the key moments, he said, early on, I remember one day standing at the water cooler there in the office with the lead pastor, and the lead pastor said these words. He said, I know I have what it takes to start a church. I just don't know what I have, if I have what it takes to sustain and grow a church. And here was sort of the key learning. He said these words. He said, in order for a church our size to go to the next level, the lead pastor has to give up to go up. Because, you know, it's like, hey, you know, when people want to get together or meet or talk, and it's like, and it's always, I want to talk to that guy, that guy, that guy, that guy, right? Like no one else can do that. And there's so many things to get done that they don't get done if the key guy keeps doing those things. And what makes it worse is I'm an extrovert, right? So I'm friendly to everybody. Hey, how you doing? You know, like that's just who I am. But can I be honest? Thanks. Thanks, Greg. All right, I am a great coach, and I'm kind of a terrible counselor. Now, I say that, and some of you are like, that's not true. We've met with you. We've counseled with you. You're really good at counseling. That's not true at all. Let me tell you what I mean when I say that. Most of the time when people come meet with a pastor, they want someone to listen to them and love them and shepherd them and care for them and pray for them. Right? I can force myself to do those things. I can. I've done it for long enough. I can kind of push myself into that mode and make myself do it. But it's not how I'm really wired. How I'm really wired is I'm thinking most of the time about the 3 or 5 or 10 things you did that were really dumb that got you into the mess you were. And I want to tell you about them, and I want to help you to never, ever do them again. Which, can we be honest, most people don't want that from their pastor, right? It's like, I'm going to pay somebody who I don't even know to tell me those things about myself, and then I can leave them and come, and you can love and pray for me. So this is just like sort of how I am wired. And I just want to say, the elders are awesome at listening and journeying. Bud and Brian and Rod and Tony, their hearts are big. They're so good at this. I'm a little bit better at leading and directing. And then sometimes people go, well, that's perfect, Rob, because I need a coach. I don't really need a pastor. I need a coach. I want people to help me get, and which is great as long as you're engaged and in the game and on the team, right? Not, I'd like to at some point, serve Jesus and be on the team. You got to be engaged. So some of you might be going, and I'm saying this because I want you guys to identify that I get what this struggle feels like. I get this sort of tension of being overbooked and stretched and way too busy. So you could say, well, hey, that solves your problem, right, Rob? If you just stop meeting with anyone who's not a key leader, that'll free up all kinds of time. Well, I was actually doing the math. This is insane. So if we take the elders here and their families, and we take the staff and their families, and then the ministry leaders, not their families, just the ministry leaders, and the families who are part of my small group, and I said, I'm not going to meet with anyone ever unless it's an emergency except those people, that represents 100 people. 100, those just those groups, 100 of you. So if I'm just hanging out with just 100 of those people, I'm still overbooked. It's crazy how this is. And so this idea doesn't help at all. It actually makes me feel more guilty sometimes because I love you guys and I want to help. And let me say this, and I want some of you who know me well, Mark, you can say this, Bud, you can say this. Rob, you guys are my small group. You can say this. Here's the thing, right? So you guys, Shelly and Greg, you can say this too. There is nothing that is more special about me than the other key leaders on our team. Amen. Don't say it too enthusiastically, though. No, I'm just kidding. And you know what? Because I'll just be honest. Sometimes, oh, no. I got to meet with you because there's something special. You're the guy, right? Like, I hear, and to be honest, it makes me feel good. Thank you for that. It's just not true. And again, in some ways, others are better at this. And there are times in the church year where you know, things are extra busy. Heading into Christmas, I've talked to a ton of you guys about this. Heading into Christmas is crazy. Heading into Easter, crazy. And so there are times in the year, there are these moments where I can rob my family because we got something we got to get done. And so I'm like out to crazy hours and busy and in meetings and all this kind of stuff. I will rob my family for a minute for a specific purpose, but I will not rob my family. I just won't, because I've done that before. And over time, if I rob my family and my family's health starts to deteriorate, that doesn't serve me or you or Jesus or anyone, okay? And so, and here's the thing that I think is just crazy. I actually think that what the church needs, not just our church, but every church, is leaders and pastors who understand more important than someone to meet with is leaders who will set an example of what it means to prioritize the things that are actually important. And so I just, again, I want you guys to sort of feel this vibe that I get it, man. I feel like stretched and pulled and overbooked in this tension. So what do we do with this overbooked problem? How do we cope? Because we all get this. Well, let me give you one thing. We've sort of done this fairly consistently. You know, we closed the office the week between Christmas and New Year to kind of give everybody a break. And historically, we've done it. We did it in the last couple of years because Liam was born. But we've gotten out of Dodge. We've just turned our phones off and like driven a lot of times up to Canada because that's where my mom lives. And so we did that, like I shared with you, and it was really, really cool. I want to show you a picture here. Grandma Patterson got to meet Liam for the very first time. And she's a great grandma. She has the grandma thing figured out. She lives in this assisted living place, and she like steals the cookies and wraps them in cellophane. And so, you know, Liam, when he shows up and he's like, I've heard your voice over the phone, but we've never met, so I don't know you. And, you know, she's not going to force it, but she goes, you want some cookies? Liam's like, yay! You know, like that's, so it was really awesome to spend a week up there connecting. I think we got to make sure that we have these ebbs and flows in our life. And when we have busy seasons, we also have less busy seasons where we pull back. And this 4-week series is all about how we can deal with our busyness and have a better, more focused, and freer 2016. Does that sound like something you're interested in? You want to have a better, more focused, and freer 2016 so you can make a bigger difference with your life. And this is one of those times of year, isn't it, where we actually have a little bit more kind of energy and steam in our sails because we're like, you know, some of you, this 2016 is going to be the year I do this, right? I'm gonna lose weight. Now, some of you said to me, hey, Rob, it looks like you've lost some weight. It may just be the look of victory. That could be. I'm sorry. The truth hurts sometimes. I apologize. Actually, if you really want to lose weight, sorry, John. Yeah. Darth Vader this morning told me, being in that suit every week for multiple gatherings, he lost 15 pounds. So you may want to borrow the Darth Vader suit and just wear it around your house. That's a way. So you know, this is a time of year where steam builds. The idea of clearing our plates and living better, more focused on purpose lives, we kind of get some traction with that. But as much as enthusiasm can motivate us, have you ever noticed that enthusiasm kind of comes and goes? You can be fired up about something for a day or two, but then that may go away. And one of the things that's a little bit more common and consistent, a motivator, tends to be worry. Have you ever known someone like this? Are you someone like this where you just worry and stress out about everything? Right? And sometimes we have these rare people who can take even a non-issue and make it into the worst case scenario possible, right? And so as we kind of jump into this idea, I want to show you a video. Check this out.
How was work?
Nothing unusual. Email was down again. And Bill called me into his office again.
What's wrong?
Nothing really. He just thinks he can come down and fit in with these blue collar guys. You know, he's white collar.
Or you've done something wrong again. And you're getting in trouble. And you'll get demoted. Then you'll stop shaving. There goes my vacation. Maybe you'll even get fired. And then you'll do that lazy thing and I'll have to go back to work. And there goes the house. We had plans for this house. We'll be living out of our car or out of the street, and eventually we'll be forced to move in with your mother.
How was your day, Kim?
Well, Dana's having a party Friday night and I thought I could go. But before you freak out, it's not gonna be that big of a deal. I mean, y'all guys know me.
You're a great kid, but there's no stopping the peer pressure. It just takes one sip and you're hooked. And then there's the smoking and the piercings and the tattoos and the boys. Even good boys don't have good intentions, never mind the bad boys. Oh, and you'll go straight for one of the bad boys and he'll introduce you to all the bad things and you'll get pregnant and drop out of school and we'll never see you again. And we'll be stuck with your kid.
What about you, Mom?
I've been considering taking up string art.
No.
Desi's been doing some really wonderful things with it. You can do anything with string. Did you know you can make refrigerator magnets?
Everyone knows string art is a gateway craft. You'll start knitting and making me hats and scarves and sweaters and making me wear those sweaters. And you'll stop dyeing your hair and get those grandma glasses and you'll want a cat, which will kill my allergies and probably lead to more cats. And you'll want to make things and bring it to my class and embarrass me in front of all of my friends.
Is this a cat hair?
That is great, isn't it? So today I want to have a conversation about worry, work, and worship. So if you worry, if you are overbooked, this week in this series may not be fun or it may not be easy, but it will be helpful. Let's pray. God, I want to thank you just for the natural enthusiasm that comes at this time of year as we think about resolutions and as we think about things we can change. And God, while that energy is still high, I pray that you would help us to take some good, healthy steps, not just in our lives in general, but God, some good, healthy steps with you. Steps that don't fade away or disappear along with gym visits and workouts in a couple weeks, but may these things stick and transform us into who we want to be and, Lord, into who you want us to be. So we ask these things together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That's awesome. So let me give you a bit of a working definition for worry. Worry is this: a state of concern and uncertainty over actual or potential problems. That's the best part, isn't it? Not just over actual problems, but problems that are potential problems. So people are worried. And the idea of positive change in our lives can be exciting, but that can quickly devolve into worry as well. There are people in this room right now, and you live your life stressed out. You live your life full of anxiety. You may have very little sleep some nights, not because your sleep schedule's messed up or you watch too much TV or drink caffeinated beverages late at night, but because you just live life with so much stress, you lay your head on your pillow and you're just instantly wide awake and you don't know how to move past that. And the crazy thing is, we feel this way sometimes from problems we have. We also feel this way from potential problems that we don't even have yet, right? We just may have them at some point and we're stressed about that. And if that's not bad enough, a lot of times we feel this kind of worry and this anxiety from things that we can't change or do anything about anyway. Isn't that crazy? And I think God has some helpful things to say to us about this very real struggle. So I want you to look with me in Matthew chapter 6. We're going to look at some verses from 25 through 34. This is the Sermon on the Mount, these three chapters in Matthew. This is Jesus' most famous teaching. And these three chapters are chock full of all kinds of practical things for how you and I can live our lives. It's a great section. And the words we're going to look at today come right after a section that's talking about storing up treasure in heaven, not on earth, which is, you know, it sounds good, but it's hard, isn't it? Because a lot of us were thinking about the treasures we'd like to have here and now. And these few verses that precede talk about how we can't serve two masters. We can't serve God and money. And so for so many people then and for us today, it's difficult because we can tend to think this. If you've thought this, I certainly have. Just stick your hand up. If I just had some more money, my life would be a lot better. Anyone else? Right? Come on. If I just had some more money, my life would be a lot better. We think this, and so it pushes against some of this whole idea of kind of where we invest and what we do. Now, I have a really cool story from yesterday about how awesome you guys are at doing this very thing. We did a pancake breakfast where there was pancakes and sausage. And one of the reasons we did this is because we had some videos playing. We didn't like have a program or anything like that. We had some videos playing about our missions partnership with Ukraine. So Pastor Taras, who was here last year, he had a little video, and I had one, and some different people who went there on the team this last year had one. It was really cool. And we had our avalanche buckets out. We didn't really draw attention to it, but it was just an opportunity for people who came and ate pancakes and sausage, which is good, a good enough reason to come to something, right? If there's pig product, that's like something to live by for 2016. If pig product's going to be there, you should go. And so we did this. And so we just had opportunities, because here's the thing. You remember last year, the first weekend of February, Pastor Taras spoke, and we took an offering in these buckets, and we said, whatever comes in, we want to support him as a church. Because here's the deal. He was a part-time pastor who kind of pastored on the side because he had to have a day job. And we figured it out, and we're like, you know what? For $3,000, we could pay his salary for a year. For $3,000, because of just the exchange rate and all that kind of stuff. So we're like, that's like a no-brainer, isn't it? And so we did this not knowing how much would come in and how we'd have to figure the rest out. And in that one day, we had $3,500 given in these buckets, which was awesome, right? It was awesome. Well, now we're getting back to that same time of year, and it's like, hey, we want to re-up, because here's the awesome news. Because we gave that one-time investment, he was able to focus. There are more people who know Jesus. His church has grown. The impact there has increased. We have people going there. We're actually bringing a team of them from Hope Church over here the week of Easter, before Easter and over Easter. So that's going to cost money too. So we need to, you know, we didn't take an offering yesterday. We're not taking an offering today per se. But yesterday at the pancake breakfast, you guys gave $1,600 to help with that. Which is awesome. So again, we're not taking an offering for this today, but these buckets are here and I see money in them. So if anybody like feels compelled by God to help, hey, there's some 50s. That's pretty sweet, right? So you know what? If you want to be a part of what God's doing, this isn't like, hey, you know, give and we're after we take our administrative fee. No. We're like, this is just like we're giving it away money to make a difference and be a part of God's work all over the world. So that's what that is. If any of you want to drop money in there after the service today, that'd be awesome. So let's continue and look at what this passage tells us. It says this: therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? So if I was summarizing this, here's how I would say it. Do not worry about anything, right? Now here's the thing. This idea of not worrying is a biblical command. And I'm pausing here with my arms big like this for a second because I want you to feel the weight of that for a minute. It's a command biblically that we don't worry. But isn't that a lot easier said than done? Right? Don't worry ever about anything. Yeah, that sounds good, Rob. I'll just pretend like I'm not worrying about it the next time I see you. right? That's kind of how we feel. And we see that this is talking about, don't worry about life, in particular our provisions, our food and our drink. And not to worry about our body and the provisions for that, namely clothes. These are sort of the three examples we see here. And as we continue reading, we're going to see that this sort of stress over and over about not worrying about these three areas in particular. And it will also repeatedly stress this next point as well. So watch how this passage continues. It says this: look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And are you not much more valuable than they? So let me give you the summary of this now. Here's how I would say it. You are more valuable than the stuff God automatically looks after. Isn't that cool? Like this, the birds, right? They don't have to like figure it out and have a plan and have a little barn where they... No. Like God just sort of makes sure they have what they need. Now this is easy to understand, isn't it? So let me just sort of say it. You are more important than a bird. God feeds the birds. God won't let you starve. That makes sense, doesn't it? We get that. But for some of us, this is hard to believe. Yeah, Rob, that sounds good, but I still better go do all the things I need to do, right? To make sure I have food and drink and clothes. For some of us, we kind of have a low opinion of ourselves, and you may not really know that you agree that you're more valuable than a pesky little bird. And even if you do believe that you're more valuable, it's hard to trust this. It's hard to lean into this. So a couple ideas we have seen so far. First one is that God will look after me, right? I don't have to worry. God's going to look after me, all the things that I need. And that sometimes the stress in our lives comes from the needless extra we want and not the idea that God isn't provided. This is true, isn't it? Sometimes we're like, man, God hasn't provided, but it's because we've taken what he has provided and we've bought something we want that we didn't necessarily need, and now we don't have enough for the things that we need. And that's on us, not on God, right? And so as we see this, we go to the next idea, which is this. You go, well, Rob, I get it, right? Like, if I don't have food for a few days, nothing's going to happen to me. I can manage that one, right? But what about the really serious stuff? Am I really not supposed to worry about that? Like, what if there's a terminal illness and there doesn't seem to be any miracle coming? What if a key relationship in your life is just being decimated? How in the world are we not supposed to worry about that? Now, this next verse is not easy. It's like going to the gym in January and you're on the treadmill thinking you're going to die because you haven't run since last January, right? So it's not easy, but it's extremely helpful if we will receive it. Listen to these words. Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? See, it's not that worrying does not help. It's that worrying does not help at all. Even one little bit. It doesn't help at all. In fact, worrying hurts. Have you ever experienced this? This idea that worry becomes this destructive curse. Have you ever had something in your life that caused you anxiety or worry or stress, and you finally got to the point where you were beginning to move past it, and then all of a sudden you got around one of these kind of negative worry, worst case scenario people, and they're like, oh, I can't believe it, it's so bad, and you were kind of getting to a healthy place, and what did they do? They added stress, and so the good life that you had to live, it was stolen. And it was infused with negativity and extra anxiety that God did not intend for you. And so watch how this continues. We'll look at a few slides here. It says this: and why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? You of little faith. So the idea here is, if you will trust him, God has got you covered literally, right? If you trust him, he'll cover you. He'll close you. And it may not be in a pair of $270 designer jeans, but it'll be something adequate. Now, here's an interesting thing. I actually was doing some study this week, and considering inflation, people actually, Solomon was the wealthiest person, wealthiest king of his time. Solomon was the wealthiest person in the Bible. And scholars actually think that considering inflation, Solomon would have been the wealthiest person who ever lived. Now let's think about this for a second. The guy who had more money and more stuff and more gold and more everything than anyone has ever had, the richest person ever, couldn't hold a candle to a flower of the field that is here today and withers and is gone tomorrow. Isn't God incredible? And if he can do that for a flower, what could he do for us if we would trust him? Now watch how this continues. This is really cool. It says, so do not worry saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things. And your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Now, pagans were people who worshipped anything or anyone other than God. Those who did not know and had not experienced the faithfulness and the provision of the one true God. They lived their lives full of worry, with the pressure of trying to figure these key things out. What are we going to eat? What are we going to drink? What are we going to wear? And how in the world are we going to get it or afford it all? Now, Bethany hung out with somebody just a couple days ago who said, man, I just wish there was a job description for Christians. Like, just tell me what to do. And I think that we kind of see a little bit of this here, don't we? And so let me ask a question that kind of helps us dig that up a little bit. In this way, do you act like a Christian or a pagan? Are you the kind of person who is spending tons of time or sleepless nights worrying about these things? Or do you trust God's provision? My favorite part of this verse is the part that says, your heavenly Father knows that you need them. As a dad, I'm going to be honest with you for a second. As a dad, there are times I ignore Christopher. As a parent, can anyone else relate? And the times that I ignore him are the times that sound like this. Hey, Dad! 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 Hey, Dad, can I do this? Dad, can I have that? Dad, Dad, here's what I need. Dad, 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 Dad. Right? And the reason that I ignore him, not forever, but the reason I ignore him is because I hurt him the first time. And I want him to know that I am his father who loves him. And I delight not only in giving him the things that he needs, which he always gets. But come on, I delight in giving him the things that he wants too, right? We do this as parents, don't we? And so what I want isn't for him to pester me over and over and over again. I want him to ask, and then I want him to know that I'm his dad who loves him and wants to give him good things. And I wonder sometimes if God doesn't sort of treat us the same way when we're like, hey, God, 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 I need this. Hey, God, I'm down here. Like we have to act like a fool, waving our hands about in order for God to know what we need. Now, God wants us to tell him and talk to him and have a relationship with him. But part of that is knowing and believing that he knows what we need and wants to give us the good things that only he can. Because here's the thing, let me just ask, do you guys believe that God knows everything? And so if God knows everything, doesn't God also know what you need and what I need? I just think this is incredible. And you know, how much of the time do we struggle with this whole idea? Because we just, you know, we wish we had more. We want more. It's all about more, 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 more in our culture. It's funny. I told you we were up in Canada, and And it was great. It was awesome to spend time with family. And some of you have asked the question, hey, do you, you know, well, it's looked, I saw pictures on Facebook. Looked like you guys had a great time. We did have a great time. It was great seeing my sister every day and my mom every day. But you guys know this, right? When you travel, it's great, and it's great to see people. But there's also challenges, right? You know what I'm talking about? And so can I tell you about a couple of our challenges? So challenge number one was my sister has a couple pets. The cat has diabetes and its back legs don't work. So when it climbs the steps, they drag behind. It's like, I don't even like cats. And it was traumatic experience to watch this cat sort of go around. And then her St. Bernard died. And so she got a new St. Bernard that's like 1 year old and it's 140 pounds. And both of these animals shed like their lives depended on it. Right? So like instantly, like there's like pet hair everywhere. Like you put clothes on and you're instantly covered in pet hair. And I'm not really allergic, but all week long my nose was just like blown up and stuffed and running. And it took me like a half a week this week to recover from all of that. And of course the Saint Bernard has a drool problem. So there's always drool hanging from its jowls and hitting the floor, and there's drool claws everywhere to wipe it up. But, you know, some of it hits the floor, and some of it doesn't get noticed. And so you're walking along, and you step in some. And then if you take one more step, of course, all the pet hair in the area comes to your foot and makes you look like a Sasquatch, right? So that was part of our week. We had to get home and wash everything like 10 times to make sure that we don't have pet hair everywhere. And then we stayed upstairs where the two bedrooms are, And there's a downstairs, it's kind of a small house, but downstairs plenty of room for my sister and her son. But downstairs there's a bathroom that's been remodeled that has like room to kind of move about in and have a shower. Upstairs, there's the bathroom that we got to use most of the time that is literally this big. Like my back is at the door, and like here to there. And right here is a sink that's literally this big. There's no mirror, there's no towel, there's no soap. So I don't know what you do with that sink, but it's there. And then right beside the toilet, which is here, like right here, is like where the cat food is, so the cat that doesn't like function properly can open the accordion door, which it can do, and join you for some eating while you're using the facilities. The most interesting thing about this bathroom that's tiny anyway is that it's upstairs, and it was an afterthought, I think. And so the roof line goes like this, right? So if you want to pee like a guy, you either have to do some kind of like interesting lean or just kind of like hope that you kind of make it. Because, you know, or the other option, should you want to do that or something else, is to close, because you can't, if I took four inches of in, I'm hitting my head. You can also do this and go like this and back in and sit down. That's the other option. I'm not telling Kendra. The first morning we were there, Christopher, we were upstairs watching some TV in my sister's room. Christopher comes and he's rubbing his head. I'm like, hey, son, what's wrong? And here's what he said. He said, Dad, I hit my head going in and coming out. So here's the thing. I say that to say, when we're dealing with this sort of issue, you know, we all of us, it's true, right? We're thankful for what we have. We just kind of wish we had a little more, right? Anyone else live life like that? Thankful for what I have. I just wish I had this. Being up there for a week was an awesome reminder of how blessed we are. We have a crazy energetic dog, but it doesn't shed, you know, and it doesn't drool, and our bathrooms aren't as big as we wish they were, but we don't have to worry about, like, life-threatening injuries when we go into them. Wow. So, man, God knows everything that we need. Now, the second last verse is the key verse here. This is the verse, if you were my friend in high school or college and asked me, would I sign your yearbook? This is the verse I wrote in your yearbook. This is the payoff verse. This is where the help comes from. It says this, Matthew 6:33, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, And all these things will be given to you as well. All of the basic needs, all the provisions, the necessities. If we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, this is something all of us should memorize. Matthew 6, 33, it's not very many words, because the general idea is so powerful. If we keep our eyes on Jesus and focus on him, his work, and his kingdom, here's the kicker, first, not as part of the mix or an afterthought, but if we focus on him and his kingdom first, then he will look after and provide for our basic needs. All right, Rob, well, what does doing this actually look like? I'm glad you guys asked me that. So I want to show you some things. I've already given you some definitions. And where's, hey, Vanna Markle, will you come up and help me? Will you guys welcome Laura? So I have a few things here, and I gave a definition for worry already. It's the state of concern and uncertainty over actual or potential problems.
This is taller than I am.
You can adjust that if you need to. Well, now we can, none of the rest of us can see it.
All right,
so you can have that one. And then work, I don't just mean your job or your vocation. I'm talking about like action, like we're doing something, we're engaged, we're moving about. And then the last one is worship. And by worship, I don't just mean coming to church or singing some songs like it was our time of worship. Here, what I mean is living with and for God, giving our lives to him. And the definition comes from Romans chapter 12, verse 1, that says this: "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies, to give ourselves as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Right? So that's what worship is. When we give ourselves to God, it's making God first. And so I want us to arrange these in some different ways, but here's how I want you to think about this. We have our life, right? All of us have our lives, and then we have different things that kind of fill up or become components of our life. And I want you to think of the thing on the bottom as being the foundational thing, the place we start, the place that's more important, not as a hierarchy where we build and the top becomes most important. It's the foundation, so the thing that's on the bottom. And I want to show you a couple ways that we typically orient our lives around these things. So the first one is we start with worry. Worry's the bottom, right? And this is where we're like, oh man, this is what motivates us, right? Like, oh, I got to get this done. I got to figure this out. I don't know what to do. And we worry and we have anxiety and it increases. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. And then in the middle, we throw worship. We want God to be a part of it because here's what we think, right? We think, well, you know, I'm worrying. And we throw a couple prayers up because we think, well, that'll probably help, or at the very least, it can't hurt. And then this kind of leads us to working, movement, action. We're trying to do things to change our reality. Now, here's the deceiving part. This sometimes works. It's like the stopped clock being right twice a day. And when it works, it causes us to think that starting from a place of worry can be helpful. And I just want you to know that this is never the best path. It's never the best thing to start from a place of worry. It's not good. Now, there's another way we can orient this, and it's we're going to switch the bottom to. So we're going to start with worship. We're going to start with a focus on God, on giving our lives to God and focusing on him, kind of like the text said that we've been looking at this morning. So this is when we begin with God. We might pray. We might read the scriptures. We might participate in community, be a part of a small group, or engage with some Christian friends who can journey with us. We may come to church, even in busy seasons where you don't know that you can really spare the time. Maybe you are here at church today as kind of a bit of a New Year's resolution to see if it'll actually make your life any better. Now, here's the thing about this. Worry's in the middle. And I think sometimes as Christians, we get worried that we worry at all. Isn't that crazy? I'm a little bit worried. I'm stressed out. I shouldn't do that. Oh, it's bad as a Christian. And now we're worried about our worry. Can I just say this? As someone who's followed Jesus for decades now, and there's some of you in this room who have followed Jesus for decades more than me, can I just say that there's anxiety that's a part of life? That we get stressed out sometimes? And that's okay. It's not the place you want to start, But it is okay that that's kind of a part of life, because here's the cool thing. When we start with worship, when we start with God, that worry, that stress, that anxiety becomes manageable. This is when people will look at you and say, man, I can't believe you're even functioning still. How are you doing that? And we start to think, well, I don't know. How am I doing that? And it's because we started with God, because we focused on Him first. And then we get to work last. We sort of out of focusing on God, even though we're concerned and worried about some things, we sort of move to work. And here's the good news. If you seek God first, everything else will be blessed more. This is the best path by far. There's no better way to do this, because it focuses and adds potency to your work. Who has a story? I'm not going to have you tell it, but just if you have a story like this, raise your hand. Who has a story? You didn't think you had time for God, so you just sort of, I'm not going to church today. I'm not going to small group. I'm just too busy. I can't do the God stuff. And then all the stuff you needed to get done took way longer, and there was no blessing in that. Anyone have that ever happen to you? And then you're like, I don't have time for God, but you know what? It's the right thing to do, so I'm going to do it. And then all the stuff that was overwhelming actually got done, and God blessed it and made it easier. Anyone have a story like that? Look at all these hands. Because this isn't just an idea. This actually works in your life. If you're kind of wondering, I don't know if I believe that, come talk to one of us who raised our hand, and we'll tell you a story about how this worked for us and works over and over and over and over. So one more way to do this. Let's put work at the bottom and worship at the top. Now, when we do it this way, this is where we start by working our tail off, right? We work, and then we worry, of course, because, oh, I'm working like crazy. Thank you, Vanna Markle. Thanks, Vanna. So we're working like crazy, and it's causing us all kinds of anxiety because we hope that it leads to, and here's the thing, we hope that by working, and we're worried about it too, but we hope that at some point we can free up enough time to get to the worship part, to get to God, because we care about God and we want to do the God thing, we just don't know if we can. And so here's how it works in our minds. It's like we want to get there, but realistically you say to yourself, I just can't yet. But I want to get there. I want to get there as soon as I can. So I'm going to work. Now this is the most sinister and destructive of all the ways to live. Because even though you appear to be a hard worker, your life communicates that you think you can accomplish more than God can. Isn't that crazy? I mean, we live in a culture that so values the idea of working and working hard. But when we make work the place that we start, the most important thing, what we say to God is, my work can accomplish more than your presence in my life. And so we work and we worry. And when we live life in this way, we almost never, ever, ever get to God. We want to. We're good-hearted about it. But because we're doing all these things that ultimately don't ever make the biggest difference, we never, ever, ever get there. So let me say it this way. Worry, if you start with worry, worry plus nothing equals anxiety. If you're a worrier, it's just going to make you more anxious and more stressed. Worrying is not a good place to start. If you work, if you have work and nothing else, work plus nothing equals exhaustion, right? At some point, you're just going to wear out. You're going to be exhausted. But here's the thing. Worship. Remember, we said this is about focusing our lives on God. Worship. Really, let's say it differently. We said this a lot. Jesus plus nothing still equals everything. Equals everything. Not stress and anxiety or exhaustion. Jesus plus nothing equals everything. He's always the best place to start. And so here as we end, let me show you the final verse, which was alluded to in the video we saw a little bit ago. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Amen? So the idea here is take things as they come with an unshakable focus on Jesus. Right? Everything's coming at us. You may be here today and you may be stressed out. There are things that you need to do, that you need to figure out. And that's plenty for today without being concerned about all the things that may or may not pop up tomorrow or next week or sometime in the future or maybe even never. Right? Take today's problems and deal with them, and don't take that next step. And let me commend you, if that's true for you, just being here today is one small way that you can put God first and begin to invite his faithfulness and provision into your life. Isn't that cool? Just being at church today on like the beginning maybe of the blizzard of 2016, it's like I saw a stop sign almost bent over when I was getting ready to walk up here to teach today. You just being here says to God, God, we want to put you first in one of the many ways you can do that. So let me ask a question. In this way, will 2016 be any different for you? Are you going to choose not to worry and make focusing on God and his work first in your life? Let me say it a different way. Are you going to worship God with an intensity that you have never, ever, ever brought to this area of your life before? God, 2016 is going to be different. I got stuff that I'm worried about, but I'm going to worry a little bit later. I'm going to start by focusing on living for and worshiping you with my whole life. We're going to close today. I'm going to pray for us afterwards, but we're going to close today. I'm going to show you just a fun video. It's kind of about making a difference in New Year's resolutions. And as you watch this, if the scripture or some of the stories or whatever has caused you to say, you know what? I don't just want to make up some kind of, 2016 is going to be different in a way that you never follow through. But for you, if you sort of feel like, you know what? I do want to worry less. I do want to put God first more and focus on him and his work and his kingdom. And I'm going to do that. If you would like to say that to God, and just in your own way as you watch this video, whether that's in your mind, kind of in the silence of your heart, whether you want to talk to the person maybe you came with on your drive home or me afterwards, I don't care what it is. But if it's time, if you feel like this is the time, I want to take this step, I'm ready to take this step, God is asking me to take this step, be sure to tell him that in the way that makes sense for you. Let's check out this video.